In this second part of the lecture covering pharmacology of antibiotics, we are going to cover nucleic acid synthesis inhibitors, protein synthesis inhibitors, and metabolic pathway inhibitors. Now let's discuss these one by one in detail, starting with nucleic acid synthesis inhibitors. So bacteria, just like all other living organisms, store their genetic information in the form of DNA. The cell uses DNA like an instruction manual, reading it to find out what parts it needs to make to survive and replicate. But first things first, in order to carry out their life processes, bacteria must convert their genetic information into functional molecules. This is done by using DNA as a template for the synthesis of RNA molecule, a process known as transcription. Depending on its structure, RNA can then perform tasks directly or act as a blueprint for the synthesis of functional proteins in a process known as translation. Now, it should be easy to see that drugs capable of inhibiting DNA or RNA synthesis would render the bacteria unable to create proteins and replicate. But wouldn't that be toxic to our own body cells? Well, luckily for us, bacterial enzymes that carry out synthesis of DNA and RNA happen to be different from ours, thus allowing development of selectively toxic antibiotics. The antimicrobial agents that primarily target nucleic acid synthesis include metronidazole, quinolones, and rifamycins. So now let's take a closer look at their mechanism of action. Our first antibiotic, metronidazole, is a prodrug that requires reductive activation of its nitro group. Upon diffusing across the cell membrane of anaerobic bacteria, metronidazole is converted by the bacterial enzyme pyruvate ferredoxin oxidoreductase into nitro radical anion. This highly reactive radical is thought to be the main toxic agent that attacks DNA, causing strand breaks and mutations that lead to bacterial cell death. Now let's move on to quinolones. Unlike metronidazole, the mechanism of action of quinolones involves interactions with topoisomerases, which are the enzymes responsible for the unwinding and unlinking of DNA. So in order for the bacterial cells to replicate, tightly coiled bacterial chromosome must unwind so that the DNA code can be accessed and copied. The two principal topoisomerases that perform this task are DNA gyrase, which unwinds and relaxes supercoiled DNA, and topoisomerase 4, which facilitates separation of the linked daughter DNA molecules after replication is complete. Both DNA gyrase and topoisomerase 4 are the primary target of quinolones, which bind to these enzymes and effectively inhibit their function. This in turn blocks DNA synthesis and cell growth, ultimately leading to bacterial cell death. Now, the vast majority of quinolones in clinical use are so-called fluoroquinolones, which have a fluorine atom attached to the central ring system that increases their antimicrobial activity. Examples of fluoroquinolones are ciprofloxacin, levofloxacin, moxifloxacin, norfloxacin, and ofloxacin. Now, let's move on to rifamycins. So in contrast to quinolones that inhibit DNA replication, rifamycins interfere with transcription of bacterial DNA into RNA. Specifically, rifamycins target enzyme responsible for translating DNA into RNA, called RNA polymerase. By combining with the protein of this bacterial DNA-dependent RNA polymerase, rifamycins bring all synthesis of RNA to a halt. Without RNA, the bacteria cannot make proteins that are essential for their survival, so the cell death eventually results. Examples of rifamycins are rifampin, rifabutin, and rifampentin. Now, when it comes to side effects, metronidazole commonly causes headaches, nausea, and metallic taste in the mouth. Furthermore, because metronidazole inhibits metabolism of alcohol in the body, combining it with alcohol causes unpleasant symptoms such as vomiting, flushing of the skin, tachycardia, and shortness of breath. Next, quinolones most commonly cause gastrointestinal side effects such as nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea, as well as headache and insomnia. Less common but more serious adverse effects include prolongation of the QT interval, tendon damage, and peripheral neuropathy. The mechanism by which quinolones cause these rare events is not entirely clear. Lastly, rifamycins may cause GI disturbances, flu-like symptoms, hepatotoxicity, and discoloration of body fluids, including urine, saliva, sweat, and tears, to red-orange color. Now, let's switch gears and let's move on to our next class of antibiotics, that is protein synthesis inhibitors. So, as discussed before, bacterial genes are translated into proteins through RNA. The type of RNA that carries message from the DNA is called messenger RNA, or mRNA for short. And the protein synthesizing machine to which the message is carried to is called ribosome. The bacterial ribosome is composed of two subunits, the 30S, into which mRNA feeds, and the 50S, which carries out catalytic functions. The ribosome translates messenger RNA into protein by reading the nucleotide triplets known as codons, which specify amino acids that are required to make up specific proteins. Transfer RNA, or tRNA for short, brings the individual amino acids to the ribosomal aminoacyl site, known as the A site, which then form a peptide bond with the growing chain at the peptidyl site, known as the P site. Next, the empty tRNA in the P site is released and the ribosome moves to the next codon, thereby transferring tRNA with new polypeptide from the A site to the P site. This process is repeated until ribosome encounters a stop codon that signals the end of protein synthesis. So as you may have already guessed, protein synthesis inhibitors act at a specific site on the ribosome to inhibit different steps in the protein synthesis. Now, the antibiotic classes that block bacterial protein synthesis can be divided into two groups, the 30S subunit inhibitors and the 50S subunit inhibitors. Classes of antibiotics that bind to the 30S subunit include aminoglycosides, tetracyclines, and glycylcyclines. Classes of antibiotics that bind to the 50S subunit include amphenicols, macrolides, ketolides, lincosamides, streptogramins, and oxazolidinones. Now let's take a closer look at their mechanism of action, starting with aminoglycosides. So aminoglycosides work primarily by binding to an area adjacent to the decoding site in the 30S subunit of the ribosome, where they interfere with the initiation of protein synthesis and cause misreading of the genetic code. This ultimately leads to either synthesis of non-functional proteins or premature termination of protein synthesis. Examples of drugs that belong to this class are neomycin, amikacin, gentamicin, streptomycin, and tobramycin. When it comes to major side effects, use of aminoglycosides has been associated with serious toxicities, including ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, and in rare instances, neuromuscular blockade. Now let's move on to tetracyclines and their derivatives, glycylcyclines. So just like aminoglycosides, tetracyclines and glycylcyclines also bind to the 30S ribosomal subunit. However, their primary mode of action is by blocking entry of aminoacyl tRNA molecules into the A site of the ribosome, thus preventing introduction of new amino acids to the growing peptide chain. This action is usually inhibitory and reversible upon withdrawal of the drug. Examples of tetracycline antibiotics include doxycycline, minocycline, and tetracycline. Example of glycylcycline antibiotic is tigecycline. When it comes to side effects, use of tetracyclines has been associated with GI disturbances, photosensitivity, and hepatotoxicity. Furthermore, tetracyclines have strong affinity for calcium and can accumulate in developing teeth and bones, leading to discoloration of teeth and inhibition of bone growth. Now, let's move on to our next group of antibiotics, that is amphenicols. So amphenicols work primarily by binding to 50S ribosomal subunit, where they block the peptidyl transferase center that catalyzes peptide bond formation. This prevents transfer of the elongating peptide chain to the newly attached aminoacyl tRNA, which generally results in bacteriostatic effect. Example of amphenicol antibiotic is chloramphenicol. When it comes to major side effects, intravenous chloramphenicol use has been associated with the so-called gray baby syndrome that results from the inability of an infant's immature liver to metabolize chloramphenicol. The symptoms include hypotension, abdominal distension, and cyanosis, which can ultimately lead to death. Another rare and sometimes fatal adverse effect that has been reported with the use of chloramphenicol is aplastic anemia, which can occur weeks or even months after the treatment. Now let's move on to macrolides and their close relatives, ketolides. So macrolides and their relatives appear to bind primarily to 50S ribosomal subunit near the peptidyl transferase center, where they block the peptide exit tunnel that the newly assembled polypeptides pass through on their way out of the ribosome. This results in inhibition of protein elongation process and thus bacteriostatic activity against most organisms. Examples of macrolide antibiotics include azithromycin, clarithromycin, erythromycin, and fidaxomicin. Example of ketolide antibiotic is telithromycin. When it comes to side effects, the most common ones include nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and ringing or buzzing in the ears. Less common but more serious side effects include QT interval prolongation that can lead to ventricular arrhythmia torsade de pointes, and cholestatic hepatitis that is generally associated only with the use of erythromycin. Now, the macrolide binding site in the exit tunnel happens to overlap with the binding sites of our next two groups of antibiotics, lincosamides and streptogramins. As a result, just like macrolides, lincosamides and streptogramins inhibit primarily the translocation steps of protein synthesis. Example of lincosamide antibiotic is clindamycin. An example of streptogramin antibiotic is quinupristin-dalfopristin. Quinupristin-dalfopristin is a combination of two streptogramin antibiotics which act synergistically with dalfopristin enhancing the binding of quinupristin as well as inhibiting peptidyl transferase. When it comes to side effects, clindamycin is likely to cause diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, and abdominal cramps. Furthermore, destruction of natural flora by clindamycin can lead to overgrowth of Clostridium difficile that can cause severe diarrhea and inflammation of the colon called pseudomembranous colitis. On the other hand, quinupristin-dalfopristin may cause nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and injection site reactions, including pain, burning, and irritation. Now let's move on to our last group of protein synthesis inhibitors, that is oxazolidinones. Unlike the other protein synthesis inhibitors, which primarily inhibit the elongation steps, oxazolidinones inhibit the first step of the synthesis by binding to the A site on the 50S ribosomal subunit, where they prevent the initiation of complex formation. Without functional initiation complex, bacteria can't synthesize proteins that are essential for their growth, which ultimately results in bacteriostatic or bactericidal effect, depending on the species. Examples of oxazolidinones are linezolid and tadizolid. The most common adverse effects associated with these antibiotics are nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, headache, and dizziness. Less common but potentially more serious adverse effects include bone marrow suppression, optic and peripheral neuropathy, seizures, and abnormal liver function tests. Now, before we end, let's briefly discuss our last class of antibiotics, that is metabolic pathway inhibitors. So the primary target of metabolic pathway inhibitors is the pathway the bacteria use to synthesize folic acid. Folic acid is an important vitamin that bacteria as well as humans need in order to make nucleotides and some amino acids. So as you can imagine, without folic acid, DNA replication and cellular growth would be disrupted. Now, unlike us humans who obtain folic acid from the diet, bacteria must make folic acid on their own. Bacteria synthesize folic acid by taking para-aminobenzoic acid, PABA for short, and adding a compound called pteridine in the presence of enzyme dihydropteroid synthase to form dihydropteroic acid. Then they add glutamate to make dihydrofolic acid and use an enzyme called dihydrofolate reductase to make tetrahydrofolic acid. Tetrahydrofolic acid is the metabolically active form of folic acid, which acts as a coenzyme for a number of key biochemical reactions. Now, metabolic pathway inhibitors work by interfering with bacterial synthesis of tetrahydrofolic acid. They include family of drugs called sulfonamides, or sulfa drugs, and drug called trimethoprim. So now, let's take a closer look at their mechanism of action. First, the sulfonamides act through competitive inhibition of dihydropteroid synthase. This is due to their structural resemblance to para-aminobenzoic acid. the enzyme that normally converts PABA to the precursor of folic acid, combines with the sulfonamide instead. The combination prevents tetrahydrofolic acid synthesis and thereby stops the growth of the bacteria. Examples of sulfonamide antibiotics that inhibit folic acid synthesis include sulfamethoxazole and sulfacetamide. Now let's move on to our second agent, trimethoprim. So unlike sulfonamides, trimethoprim targets the second key enzyme in the folic acid synthesis pathway, that is dihydrofolate reductase. As an analog of dihydrofolic acid, trimethoprim competitively inhibits this enzyme, thus effectively disrupting production of tetrahydrofolic acid. When it comes to side effects, sulfonamides commonly cause GI disturbances such as nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea, as well as photosensitivity. Less common but more serious side effects include renal stones, hepatotoxicity, bone marrow suppression, and allergic reactions ranging from rash or hives to anaphylaxis and Stevens-Johnson syndrome. On the other hand, side effects of trimethoprim are a little more modest and generally limited to upset stomach, nausea, vomiting, and skin rashes. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, stay tuned for more.